Recorded Books presents Puzzle Me a Murder by Roz Noonan. Narrated by Christina Moore. Chapter 1.
I'm going to kill him,
said the woman seated in the grim shadows of the kitchen nook.
Good morning. Alice Pepper yawned as she entered the kitchen and flicked on the pendant light over the oak table. I can see we're going to pick up where we left off last night.
Alice noticed that her friend was still smartly dressed in a black pantsuit with a gold and bronze striped shirt that complemented her brown skin. Probably never made it to bed. Most likely she'd sat here through the night, dozing off and stewing over the betrayal. And yet, Ruby looked fabulous. Her hair and makeup were impeccable as always. Her lips were taupe-colored with a subtle sheen, and a layer of gold eyeshadow highlighted her chocolatey eyes. Even in desperate times, Ruby Milliner maintained her polished appearance. Alice paused by the table. Honey, you look fabulous, but I have to ask, did you get any sleep at all?
I won't rest until he's breathed his last stinking breath.
That's one way to work through it.
This is not a therapeutic exercise, Alice. I'm going to kill him. A slow, painful death. That's the plan.
Ruby turned a puzzle piece in her hand as she stared blankly toward the mountains.
It's not like I didn't warn him. I told him I'd rip him apart if he ever messed around.
Coffee first.
Fastening her robe, Alice caught a fuzzy image of herself in the glass of the wide window. Her cap of gray hair sat flat against her skull, and her face seemed to be all angles. Long nose, jutting cheekbones, pointed chin. Add a white kerchief to her jaw and a ball and chain to her six-foot-tall frame, and she could have played the ghost of Jacob Marley. Not that any woman looked her best on a few hours of sleep. Not her fault. Last night, Alice had planned for some solid sleep. Today was her meeting with the mayor. An important chance to plead her case. She'd been winding down around 10 p.m. when Ruby had arrived in crisis mode. Alice yawned. She was running on a half-empty tank, which was not a good look for a woman who was no longer on the sunny side of 60.
No one should be up this early.
I never went to sleep,
Ruby muttered. That explained why her shiny black locks fell over her shoulders and curled gently at the ends. Or wait, was that a wig? With Ruby, she was rarely sure, unless she was sporting an elaborate hairstyle of twisted braids or sculpted colored hair. As owner of Ruby's House of Wigs, she had hundreds of hairpieces at her disposal, wigs that transformed her from diva to entrepreneur to hippie mama. Alice often envied Ruby for her variable looks.
He robbed me of a good night's sleep.
Ruby's voice was slightly hoarse. Poor thing.
The thief.
Alice headed to the counter that housed three methods of coffee making. Coffee pot, Keurig, or Nespresso. Definitely a Nespresso morning. Fast and strong.
So what's the best way to kill someone?
Ruby held up a puzzle piece as if it held the answer. Alice let out a weary breath as she filled the water well and started the brewing.
I don't know. A ghost gun? Poison?
I hate guns. And poison won't work. I'm too good a cook for anyone to believe I poisoned my husband.
Debatable, Alice said under her breath, not wanting to engage. Murder was not the usual topic of conversation when Alice kept company with her friends in the kitchen nook that offered a view of the green Willamette Valley below and white-capped mountains in the distance. Most days, they used the table to assemble puzzles as they sipped coffee or iced tea or something stronger. Most days, the gals enjoyed conversations meant to crack each other up. But this morning, Ruby had only one thing on her mind.
Although they seem to use poison a lot in mystery novels,
Ruby went on. Or maybe I should go with something that involves suffering.
He should have time to feel remorse.
Far be it from me to stop you from killing George, but the plotting will go better with caffeine involved.
Alice placed a steaming mug in front of Ruby. The coffee aroma began to work its magic as the second cup filled, and Alice considered her day. Ruby needed her support, but there was no way she could miss this morning's meeting with Mayor Tansley Grand. The town council had recently voted in a 10% cut to city services, and Alice was ready to fight for her library. Well, the library wasn't actually hers. It was a public library, the most used library facility in the state of Oregon. A wonderful library, and Alice was determined to defend it with her last breath. When Alice placed a spoon and sugar bowl in front of Ruby, the cell phone sitting there chimed a few times as messages popped onto the screen. "Look at that," Alice said. "It's probably George begging you to forgive him." Ruby frowned at the screen, then looked back at the puzzle piece in her hand. "Nope. He hasn't responded since last night. Running scared because he knows I don't get mad. I get even." Tough talk for a woman who was on the board of West Hazel's women's shelter and a founder of the local Animal Rescue League. Alice took a deep sip of her espresso shot, loving every note of flavor. A second sip helped her realize that Ruby's was a problem without a quick solution. "Look, honey, I've got a few minutes, and then I'll need to scram for my meeting. But remember all that deep breathing from yoga? Good air in?"
Yeah, sure.
"You just keep focusing on the puzzle. It'll keep your mind off things, and I'll be back this afternoon. Promise me you won't make a move to kill George until I get back." Just then, Violet breezed into the kitchen for her morning ginger shot. "Who's killing whom?" she asked. "Oh, Ruby, I thought I heard voices. You're here early."
"I've been here all night, and I'll tell you why."
As Ruby explained she'd caught her husband cheating, Violet grew tense, putting up her hands as if to create a barrier. "I hear you, and I feel your pain. This must be difficult for you, and I'll discuss your options later. However, in this moment, I need to be surrounded by positive energy. Parent-teacher conferences today."
"Of course. Don't let me ruin your day."
Ruby picked up her cell, which was still chiming with messages. Alice shot her sister a disapproving look. "A little empathy, please?" "My heart is breaking," Violet said, patting her chest lightly. "But I do have a school to run, so off to work I go." It must be nice to let the pain of others roll off so easily, Alice thought as she watched her sister leave through the garage door. Maybe Violet was lucky to be so obtuse. Alice had always been cursed by compassion for lonely hearts. She wanted the folks around her to be happy, damn it. "What's with these people?" Ruby scowled at her phone. "I've got a bunch of texts from Imani. George's assistant Nicole keeps asking me to call. And so does my neighbor Tiger, whom I wouldn't mind calling. Not the Tiger, but he's just as hot. What the hell does he want this early in the morning? Everyone wants a call back, and the sun's barely up." "That is strange," Alice agreed. "Especially Imani." Imani Jones was Ruby's assistant at the wig company. "She knows you don't take calls before 10.
"Everyone's crazy this morning."
Ruby planted the phone screen side down on the table and went back to trying puzzle pieces. "Aren't you going to call them back?"
"Eventually. For now, they'll just have to understand that I'm taking a mental health day. And ugh, my husband is a rotten, cheating scoundrel day. You can call the shots like that when you own the company."
"You're right." Alice took a seat at the table and cupped her warm mug. "Take some time for yourself. And what have we here?" For the first time, she glanced at the puzzle, not an image she recognized. "Did you bring this puzzle?" she asked Ruby.
"No, it was already sitting on the table. And it's a weird one, right? A nice break from all those little white children picking flowers or ice skating in any white town, USA.
Alice chuckled. "Oh, honey, we haven't done one of those for a while. But this one is quite unusual. Part graffiti, part drawing of a maid sweeping stuff under a carpet. Actually, a carpet of graffiti."
"I got it for you, Gran," said a voice behind them. It was Alice's granddaughter, Taylor,
a 22-year-old hipster who was currently squatting in the basement. Tall and lithe, with long, coppery brown hair, Taylor reminded Alice of herself when she was young. Back in the 70s, Alice had marched with her mother in a huge anti-war protest on the streets of Manhattan. Peace, love, and rock and roll. Simpler times? When you're freckled and 14, you view the world through a simpler lens.
Do you like it, Gran?
Taylor asked as she crossed to the fridge.
Well, thank you for the gift, dear.
Alice knew Taylor couldn't afford it, being behind on her discounted rent.
It's certainly unusual. Where'd you get it?
A thrift shop.
Taylor leaned into the fridge.
It's a Banksy.
Oh, right, that graffiti artist, said Alice.
Ruby tapped her chin with a shiny, lacquered nail.
Never heard of him, but I kind of like it.
Taylor emerged from the refrigerator with a pie plate half full of quiche.
Is this vegan?
It is not, Alice said.
Whatev.
Taylor found a fork and started eating. Ruby squinted down at the nearly assembled puzzle.
Your Banksy is kind of gritty and rough, isn't he?
That's Banksy's style. He's big on messages that have social impact.
The message being clean your room? Alice suggested.
I think it's more a statement on the way the Western world tries to sweep important issues under the carpet. Banksy created this piece in 2006 when AIDS was a crisis. I think he was saying that AIDS was everyone's problem, though much of society tried to ignore it.
Taylor shot Alice a probing look.
You need to catch up on your pop art, Gran.
You're right, Alice agreed. I'll get on it today. A good librarian stayed current, always learning.
Whoa, you guys did this puzzle pretty fast.
Taylor stood over them.
I dropped it here just a few hours ago when I got home and found Ruby sleeping on the table.
I was meditating, Ruby insisted.
Alice wondered what the folks at the senior center would think about Banksy. She suspected Aunt Gildy would be delighted. Alice and her friends often traded puzzles with the senior center. It was a good way for everyone to save money, and it was such a pleasure to deal with Stone Donahue, the manager of the center. Nothing serious, of course, but light encounters with Stone always helped to get the heart pumping faster.
So, if you don't mind me asking, why were you sleeping on the kitchen table last night?
Asked Taylor.
I offered her one of the guest rooms, said Alice. I was working through some things.
Ruby's doe eyes focused on Taylor.
My George did me dirty. I came home early from a business trip and caught him having an affair.
What?
Taylor gasped and took a seat at the table.
No! Tell me everything!
As Ruby spun her tale of woe one more time, Alice got up to escape. Taylor was a good listener, and right now Ruby needed to keep venting.
Will you ever forgive him? Taylor asked.
That man has only called me once since I caught him. One call! If that's all he thinks of me, he doesn't want forgiveness. He wants some pain, is what I think.
Alice left them talking about vengeance and slipped off to her suite to shower and dress. That was the beauty of Alice's house on the summit, or Alice's palace, as her ex had dubbed it when she'd held onto it in the divorce settlement. The old craftsman house on Sunset Hill had been extensively renovated to include a handful of ensuite bedrooms in the 1990s. The previous owner, some tech prince who'd fled Silicon Valley for more affordable digs, had remodeled the place with a plan to bring his genius staff up to the Portland area and lodge them here. When those plans hadn't worked out, Alice and Jeff had gotten a good deal on the house. A good deal that recently had required a second mortgage. Money was tight, but Alice would give up food and water before she'd let this house go. The dryer fluffed up her hair a bit too much, and now she resembled a fuzzy silver chick. She paused to adjust her light summer jacket over her long black dress. She had chosen the basic black dress with a geometric print jacket to convey just the right combination of professionalism and art appreciation for her meeting. Back in the kitchen, she found Taylor and Ruby staring at Ruby's ringing phone.
The cops are calling Ruby, Taylor reported, pointing to the caller ID.
The police? West Hazel's finest, Alice said, proudly thinking of Taylor's twin, Madison, who was a rookie cop. Aren't you going to answer?
I can't talk to anyone right now.
Ruby handed the phone to Taylor.
You answer.
I'm good, Taylor said, backing away. Alice was losing patience. Someone answer the phone. Trust me, you don't want me talking to the cops.
Taylor disappeared back down the basement stairs, leaving Alice to worry about her latest illegal antics. Of Alice's twin yin and yang granddaughters, Taylor had a well-earned reputation as the hellion. Fortunately, the ringing had stopped, and Ruby placed her phone back on the table.
Go away, she told the phone as if it were a pesky insect. If it's so important, you can leave a message.
Just then, Alice's cell rang, and she saw that it was a call from Taylor's twin.
It's Madison, she told Ruby.
A recent college graduate, Madison was a rookie cop with the West Hazel police. Alice began the call with,
Honey, I can't talk. Is Ruby Milliner with you?
Yes, she's here, dear.
I figured as much.
Madison sounded a bit cold.
Open your door, Gran.
You can come in, honey.
I'm here in an official capacity, so I think you need to let me in.
With a dramatic sigh, Alice ended the call and opened the door to find Madison waiting on the porch in her dark uniform pants, Doc Martens boots, and crisp white shirt with departmental regalia, badges and patches and that cold weapon on the hip. Smart and low-key, this girl knew how to get a job done, unlike her twin who couldn't hold on to a job.
It lifts my spirit to see you looking so smart in your uniform, Alice told her. Calm and dedicated, you are exactly what West Hazel needs.
Madison grimaced as she moved past Alice.
She's in the kitchen?
That's right, Alice followed behind, wondering why her granddaughter was so pale and stiff this morning.
Licking her wounds, I'm afraid she caught her husband fooling around with another woman last night.
The news didn't seem to penetrate Madison's tight demeanor.
George?
That's the lily-livered cheat, Ruby said, lifting her coffee mug.
I was trying to surprise him, seeing as this weekend's our anniversary. I left my beauty convention in Vegas a day early, thinking he'd be happy to see me. The show was supposed to end Tuesday, but I hopped a flight back to Portland last night, all buttered up for my baby.
Turned out the surprise was on me when I walked in on some blonde floozy chasing my husband through the house. My man, who was buck naked, by the way, except for some weird Renaissance mask.
This seemed to stop Madison in her tracks.
This was last night?
Indeed it was.
Did you recognize the woman?
I couldn't see her face on account of the mask she was wearing. Some sparkly thing with feathers and rhinestones. And I can't be sure, but I think the blonde hair was one of my wigs. And she may have been wearing one of my negligees, too.
Madison absorbed the information with a careful breath. This explains a few things. Of course, Ruby was so distraught she came straight here, Alice explained. It was late, 10 or 11, I think, and we talked for a while. I insisted she stay the night, though I don't think she got any sleep.
I'm still fired up, Ruby admitted. At the moment, I'm rounding the corner from sorrow to anger and starting down Vengeance Avenue, thinking up ways to kill him. You know the song, 50 Ways to Kill Your Lover.
Alice cocked her head to one side. Not sure that's how the song goes.
It's not, Madison said. And you're too late.
Ruby slipped another puzzle piece into place.
Too late for what?
I'm sorry, Ruby, but I've been sent to notify you that your husband is dead.
Chapter 2.
Are you talking about my George?
Ruby looked up from the puzzle.
I don't believe it.
Alice was equally dubious, but then she noticed the taut strain on Madison's face. That was not a mask of calm. Madison was trying to suppress her own freakout.
Our patrol officers found him on the bedroom floor, Madison said quietly.
In the loaded pause that followed,
Alice and Ruby stared at each other, doubt and dread heavy in the air. The silence was sliced by Ruby's sorrowful wail.
Oh, Ruby.
Alice went to her friend and slipped an arm over her shoulders.
Honey, I'm so, so sorry.
Alice stayed by her friend as Ruby slipped from disbelief.
It couldn't be him.
To shock.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no.
And then the questions began.
Are you sure he's dead? I mean, is he not breathing at all? Maybe it's not even him.
One of the paramedics was able to identify him. Turns out he's on George's bowling team. He's really gone. Ruby took a bunch of napkins and pressed them to her face.
How did it happen?
He may have fallen off the exercise bike and hit his head, but that's just one theory. The coroner will do an autopsy, of course. Madison winced. I might be telling you too much. I've never done this before. I'm so sorry.
You're doing okay,
Alice reassured her. It's a terrible situation.
Where is he?
Ruby dashed away tears with the balled-up napkins.
I need to see him. Is he still at the house?
He should be. Keeping her gaze trained on Ruby, Madison remained on task but sympathetic. But I wouldn't advise going over there. You don't want to see.
I need to go to him!
Ruby was digging through her handbag, tossing aside a tissue pack, lipstick, a leather case for sunglasses.
Where are my keys? I can't find my keys.
Ruby, Madison touched her arm. You're in no shape to drive.
Then I'll walk. I can walk. I'll run.
Ruby's house was only a few blocks away, but the image of her shocked, desperate friend rushing through the streets broke Alice's heart.
I'll drive, Alice said, grabbing her purse.
When she turned to shepherd Ruby out, Taylor stood by the stairs, her round-eyed expression of shock revealing that she'd heard, too.
Are you coming with?
Without a word, Taylor grabbed the tissue box from the desk and followed to the garage.
This is not a good idea, Madison called, hurrying after them.
No one answered because everyone understood. Even if it was too late, Ruby had to be there to see for herself the tangible signs of death. Without another word, Madison jumped into the back seat beside her sister. As Alice started to back the car out of the garage, Ruby dabbed at her eyes with tissues and articulated the gazillion questions in the air. How did George die? A heart attack? A stroke? He wasn't even sick. Yes, he was on beta blockers and some kind of blood thinner medicine, but he'd never had any big issues. Had the stress of having his affair discovered proven to be too much for his heart? Or maybe he had died in the saddle with Blondie?
Let's not go there yet, Alice said, turning the last corner onto Ruby's street.
Although the road was passable, it was littered with so many emergency vehicles that Alice had to park a few doors down. Their car inched past police cars, an ambulance, a fire truck, and a dark sedan with a cherry light on top. Ruby's charming, cedar-shingled two-story home with its wide, wooden sitting porch seemed to cower under the strain of strange visitors.
What are all these people doing at my house? Ruby asked.
They're here to process the crime scene and collect the...
to take George away, Madison answered. A crime scene? What crime? Ruby railed. I thought he fell off the damn exercise bike.
Just in case something nefarious happened, Madison said. I mean, it's just a precaution. Ruby shook her head in disbelief as the other women huddled around her and ushered her toward the house. A dusty black station wagon with blacked-out windows had been backed into the driveway. Its rear doors were open. At first, Alice wondered what sort of tools the police might store in the dark recesses, and then it dawned on her that the open compartment was for a corpse. It was the coroner's wagon. This was real. Looking quite official in her police uniform, Madison held her hands up to stop them at the front door.
Before you go in, you have to promise to stick near me and don't touch anything. This is an active crime scene. I keep hearing about this crime no one can explain, and it's pissing me off, Ruby said. What happened to my George?
It's procedure.
Since he appeared to die alone, we need to investigate to make sure he died of natural causes.
He died alone!
Ruby sobbed and plucked another tissue from the box in the crook of her arm. Alice rubbed her friend's back, wishing she could offer true solace. Ruby, honey, do you want to wait a few minutes and pull yourself together?
Nope.
Ruby shook her head.
Let's get this over with.
Madison opened the door of the house Ruby had shared with George Bird for the past few years and pointed the way.
Just stick with me, please.
Ruby and Alice pressed toward Taylor, who was closest to the door, but as Taylor stepped over the threshold, she paused, looked up the staircase, and pressed her hands to her cheeks.
I can't do it!
Taylor backed out, bumping into Ruby.
Whoa, girl!
Ruby braced herself against the door jamb.
You're about to knock the stuffing out of me.
Alice placed a hand on her granddaughter's shoulder. What's wrong?
I can't go in there. I keep thinking of George. What if his spirit is lingering? Sometimes people linger. Sometimes they're really pissed.
Taylor shivered in the summer sunlight.
It's too creepy.
It's just George, Ruby said. And from what they're telling me, if he's dead and gone, he's not going to say boo to you now.
Taylor crossed her arms.
I can't. I just can't do it.
So stay out here. Madison led the way inside, muttering under her breath. It doesn't always have to be about you.
I can't help how I feel,
Taylor protested. Of course, honey, Alice said, guiding Ruby past Taylor. You just wait here.
Okay,
Taylor said.
But I might wait across the street or down the block.
As if a few yards would be a barrier to a rogue spirit? Alice didn't understand the mystical world Violet and Taylor inhabited. Too many invisible elements, psychic portals, and porous veils to parallel worlds.
Believe me, George the ghost would not venture too far from the couch and TV.
Ruby reached back to hand Taylor the tissue box. Then she smoothed the collar of her blouse and set her chin.
Let's do this.
She's so immature, Madison muttered under her breath as Alice stepped into the front entryway. Although Alice tended to tamp down the tension between the twin girls, she was immediately distracted by the fleet of law enforcement that had taken over Ruby's house. Everyone was wearing paper booties and gloves, which Madison was applying to her own boots and hands. One tech spread black dust on surfaces, having made a hell of a mess on the lavender wall along the stairs. A photographer was snapping shots on his way up the stairs, which curved up from the vestibule and split right and left, providing a balconied hallway to the upstairs rooms.
Do you want to go wait in the kitchen? Madison asked.
Detective Petrosian will be here soon, and you could talk to him. He's just finishing up at another crime scene.
I want to see my George.
Ruby's doe eyes gazed up the staircase.
Is he still up there?
I think so. Madison had to hop to keep her balance as she pulled on a blue shoe cover.
But you can't.
Ruby was already climbing the stairs.
Go up. Ruby, wait.
Madison grabbed a pair of booties and followed Ruby up.
You need to cover your shoes.
Too late. Ruby was near the top, moving like a fashion model in her black wedge sandals. Alice let out a sigh as she watched their ascent. She'd seen dead bodies before. Her parents' mortal shells, and a few funeral home displays that were waxy and disheartening. If George had been in bad shape, Ruby might get a look at something she couldn't unsee. Talk about being haunted. But right now, Ruby needed a bit of protection from her own curiosity. Resolute, Alice slipped on a pair of booties from the basket by the door. Slippery little devils. Stepping cautiously, she hiked up her dress and trudged up the stairs. The hub of activity was through the main bedroom, in a wide hallway outside the walk-in closets. Madison detained Ruby at the edge of the scene, where three workers were gathered near the exercise bike. At least Ruby was calmer now, though she continued to rattle off questions, and her glazed eyes suggested that shock had set in. Moving closer, Alice overheard the workers near the bike discussing the bloodstains on the carpet there, a dark puddle that had set into a stain, a little tacky in the darkest region. Minimal splatter, someone said. Alice figured that was a peaceful sign. In mystery novels, splatter was usually a sign of violent action. Had Ruby seen the blood? She hoped the workers were blocking her view. Was that where George had fallen? It was near the bike. And where was George? Fortunately, his body wasn't in sight. Over at the bedside, the tech got a shot of a discarded blonde wig on the floor, then photographed a satiny black mask with rhinestones and peacock feathers left on the edge of the bed. Leftovers from last night's tryst, based on what Ruby had witnessed. As soon as they were photographed, another worker lifted them with long tongs and bagged them. Evidence of some role-playing, for sure. Foul play? Probably not. Over by the closet entrance, Alice spotted a long black bag on the white carpet. The bag was oblong and uneven, as if it contained snowboarding equipment. A body bag. She'd found George.
Wait! Ruby's voice was louder now. What's that stain on my white carpet?
As she moved closer to the huddle of investigators, one woman lifted her head and stood up straight.
Who are you and what are you doing in my crime scene?
The middle-aged gal was of solid build, and the set of her shoulders indicated she was not someone you'd want to tangle with. Dressed in jeans and a western shirt with braiding and pearlized snaps, she looked like she might have just left a rodeo, though her air of authority made it clear that she owned this space.
This is my house, and George is my husband, Ruby said, stepping forward and leaning down to reach for a fat blonde braid, a hairpiece, that lay on the rug. Don't touch anything, the western gal surged forward to block Ruby's motion. But it's my hairpiece, and this is my house.
Honey, Alice winced at the braid on the floor. You don't really want that thing back now, do you?
Actually, I don't. But it's mine, Ruby insisted.
Western gal heaved a sigh.
Who let this woman in?
She's with me, Jane, explained Madison. This is Ruby Milliner. She's the wife of the deceased.
Yeah, I got that the first time, but she shouldn't be in here.
Jane pressed her iPad to her chest and straightened to face Ruby.
Listen, Ruby, I'm Dr. Jane McAllister, the county coroner. I'm sorry for your loss, ma'am. This is a difficult time for you, but you really don't want to be here. Why don't you wait downstairs while we finish up? I can't. I need to see him.
Not a good idea. This is not how you want to remember him. And he's on his way out of here, Jane said, turning away.
That's your cue, Miguel.
Two of the forensic guys scrambled to lift the body bag onto a stretcher. Dr. Jane barked more orders as they lifted George's body and headed toward the door.
After you transport the deceased to the morgue, make sure you do one more thorough search for hair and fibers. No, wait, Ruby insisted. George can't go. I have to see him. I have to know. Maybe it's not even him. You might have some other poor stiff in that body bag.
I get it, Ruby. You need to know, Alice said, trying to think of a quick way to dissuade her friend. The bloodstains on the carpet suggested that the body might be a gruesome sight. We could go identify him later. I'll go with you, she took Ruby's hand. This is going to be traumatic for you. I just don't think you want to see him this way right now.
But I have to know if it's him. I need to know now. Maybe my George isn't dead.
I can assure you he's gone, the coroner said. We already got an ID from one of our medics who was acquainted with the deceased.
So he's been identified, but Ruby needs to see for herself, Alice said. Dr. Jane, do you have a photo that Ruby could see? Something to help her know that George is truly resting in peace?
I think we got that.
Jane lifted her iPad and started scrolling through.
Where's Photoshop when you need it?
She frowned, scrolled on, and then nodded.
Here we go. Here's your husband, Ruby.
Alice leaned closer to Ruby, hand on her shoulder, for a look at the screen. And there was George Bird. The image showed one side of his face, which, thank goodness, was not bloodied. Although his skin looked pale, his eyes were closed,
almost peaceful. Ruby seemed to melt beneath her palm, deflating.
That's my George.
For a moment, the room went silent. Even the forensic techs paused, respectful and somber.
I'm sorry for your loss, Jane said. Oh, George,
Ruby spoke softly.
What happened to you?
She glanced up at the coroner.
What happened to him?
That's what we're here to find out. Dr. Jane slipped her iPad into a fringed leather pouch she wore slung over one shoulder. And now, you need to let me do my job. Miguel, are we about done here?
Yes, Doc.
Did he kill himself?
Ruby pressed her palms to her cheeks.
Oh, Lordy, the guilt drove him to kill himself. Maybe I was too hard on him.
Well, if you were, he didn't commit suicide. He suffered head trauma and his wounds were not self-inflicted.
Maybe he hit his head from falling off the exercise bike, Alice suggested. An accident.
Jane shook her head. This carpet would have had a softer impact than the wounds indicate, and a fall like that wouldn't affect this portion of his head. George suffered multiple contusions, blunt force trauma to the back of the head.
Alice stared at the exercise bike, trying to imagine a scenario in which George would have hurt the back of his head. Even if he had fallen back and hit his head on the handlebars, he would have suffered one wound, not many.
Dr. Jane, help us out here, Alice said, even as the answer came barreling toward her. Blunt force trauma, back of the head. Her heart thudded at the realization, but she needed to hear it.
Ruby won't rest until she has a better idea of what happened to her husband.
I need to do a thorough autopsy. Blood work. His lips are awfully blue. Jane squeezed one pearlized snap on her shirt, spelling it out slowly, clearly. Most likely, he died of head trauma, and the wounds were not self-inflicted.
What do you mean?
Ruby squinted, unable to comprehend.
You're saying that he was murdered, Alice confirmed.
Dr. Jane gave a nod. As of now, this is a homicide investigation.
Chapter 3 Murder. The idea of someone killing George, bumbling, fun-loving, thigh-slapping George, was difficult for Alice to grasp as she corralled Ruby downstairs and found her a seat at the kitchen table. The room seemed to be fairly safe from foraging investigators and fingerprint dust. Madison explained that the kitchen and dining room seemed to be untouched by last night's occupants and thus had been left alone. Ruby had sobbed all the way down the stairs, poor thing. Even with George's body sealed in the black bag, the reality of his death had become vivid in that room upstairs.
I can't believe someone killed my George, Ruby said in a warbling voice. He was a good man, always cheerful, always trying to make people smile.
Maybe it was an accident, Alice suggested as she sat on a white leather chair.
Ruby's square-backed chairs matched perfectly with the gray-veined Carrara marble table, a look Alice could never pull off in her casual kitchen. Ruby possessed an exquisite sense of fashion and design. Classy, Alice's mother Clara used to say in her brassy Queen's accent. At the center of the white marble sat a shiny black bowl of fragrant lemons and a fat envelope with an old-time illustration. It took Alice a moment to recognize it as a dress pattern.
What's this? Alice asked. A simplicity pattern? Brings me right back to our youth.
As a kid, Ruby had followed in the tracks of her seamstress mother and sewn many a dress on the trusty singer. Lovely creations in colorful fabric and just the right amount of lace or satin trim. Alice, in her worn hand-me-down dresses, had envied her so. By high school, Ruby had taken Alice under her wing, instructing Alice on the purchase of butterick patterns and fabric, lots of fabric, so that her friend could sew dresses that fit Alice's ever-growing beanpole figure. That had been back in grade school, younger days,
simpler times. They'd been neighbors back in Queens Village, New York, best friends through their college years. After that, their paths had meandered, sometimes intersecting only once every few years. Distant but close, until Ruby's husband Darnell had passed away some 10 years ago, and Alice had enticed her friend to get out of New York and move to Oregon. Ruby had taken a buyer's job with a West Coast retailer, which had led her to specialize in hats and accessories, which had led her to the realization that there was a real need for a full-service retailer of wigs and hairpieces for women of color. And so Ruby's House of Wigs had been born. Hard work, experience, insight, and a little bit of luck had brought Ruby success.
Would you look at that empire waist?
Glad for the distraction, Alice pointed to the sketch of the dress on the pattern. Hard to find a dress that flattering in the frocks on the store racks these days.
I got that for Ada, Ruby said, mentioning her oldest daughter. You know she's pregnant again.
She is? Congratulations. You're going to be a grandmother yet again.
My fourth. Ada was complaining that she couldn't find anything decent to wear to the wedding. I was going to whip that up for her, but she found something in the meantime.
The wedding. Alice pressed a palm to her chest. You can't possibly host after this.
I'm not throwing the wedding. Just putting up some family is all, and hosting a small rehearsal dinner.
Nothing was small in Ruby Land, but Alice wasn't going to argue. Not with a crushed expression on her friend's face as she glanced at the two arched openings, one leading to the dining room, where wedding gifts were neatly set on display, and the other showing a fraction of the activity in the living room.
Of course, no one will want to step foot in here after they find out. Forget about having pizza parties and kids sleeping on the floor. My little granddaughter was always fascinated by the exercise bike upstairs, and now I won't be able to let her go near it.
She pressed a fist to her lips and shook her head.
What am I going to do?
Alice took Ruby's hand in hers and looked into her doe-like brown eyes. You're going to get through this, honey. One step at a time. Ruby closed her eyes and let out a shaky breath.
Thank you for being here. You're a good friend.
Of course I'll be here. The promise reminded Alice that she was supposed to be in downtown West Hazel in the next hour, having breakfast with the mayor. She hated to cancel her fundraising plea to Tansley Grand, but for now, this was where she needed to be. A tapping noise behind Alice startled her to swing around. A head popped into view at the kitchen door, evoking dual gasps from Alice and Ruby. Taylor.
Let me in, she called.
This girl is shaving years off my life, Alice muttered as she rose and unbolted the door.
Feeling better?
Taylor splayed her palms and cautiously pushed through the air around her.
The energy is still unstable, but non-threatening.
What a relief, Alice gestured toward the table. Come, sit with Ruby. I need to make a call.
Of course.
Taylor sat down and showered Ruby with the emotive pouts.
How you holding up, Ms. Rubleby?
Taylor's silliness could be annoying at times, but it was genuine, and sometimes that was the perfect antidote.
Been better, honey.
As they chatted quietly, Alice went into the belly of the beast, crossing through the living room to find the quiet of Ruby's office, a small room on the first floor. Relieved to find it in perfect order, she paced around the white faux fur rug and went to the window behind Ruby's glass desk where her laptops lay closed. The room was neat as a pin. Outside the window, the small expanse of green lawn filled her view as she called the mayor's office and suggested a late lunch instead of breakfast. Tansley couldn't take her call, but her assistant agreed to the change.
Her schedule is falling apart, but that should work, said Cassidy.
Alice hung up and called the library, checking in with Beto, who managed the phones and checkout desk.
All good here, Beto reported. Will we see you soon?
Not until after lunch, Alice said, thanking him before hanging up. At least her library was one place that wasn't in chaos this morning.
Remaining at the window for a beat, Alice noted that Ruby's backyard was smaller than she remembered, and from the pristine grass and patio furniture draped in customized covers, it seemed rarely used. The yard backed up to acres of public space, a city park with soccer fields and trails, which George had used when he wanted to go for a run outside. Sometimes he'd jogged past Alice when she was on one of her walks. But she wouldn't be running into George anymore. A thump from above made her scoff. George always had to have the last word. But of course, it was just the folks collecting evidence. She went upstairs to... Well, honestly, she was curious, and she knew Ruby was in Taylor's capable hands. In the primary bedroom, the cowgirl coroner was missing, probably on to her next job duty. The two remaining techs, 30-ish male and 40-something woman in a baggy jumpsuit, were deep in conversation.
"Actually, I thought the mask thing was kind of classy," the woman said. "Did you see the sparkle on her mask?"
"And what's with the wigs?" he asked.
"You can become anyone you want. Little Gretel in the Woods or Marie Antoinette."
The gal held up the bag containing the rhinestone mask and declared, "Let them eat cake."
"You know Marie Antoinette didn't exactly say that," he said.
"It's part of the fantasy. You ever dress up for sex, Dombrowski?"
He shined a flashlight under the bed, then shot her a bland look. "I find the opposite state of dress is more effective for that." She took a moment to think, then nodded. "Buck naked?" He shined the light onto his face before cutting it off. "Eyes up here." Alice looked away and smiled as the two technicians chuckled. They seemed unaware or unconcerned about her presence in the room, and she was happy to stay and observe. Dombrowski's grin faded as he scanned the room. "What I don't see is a heavy, loose object that could have been used to clock them. They've got no free weights, no heavy lamps or chairs, nothing you could grab onto and take a swing."
"Yeah, I don't see any possible weapons in sight.
And we know the victim didn't smack us out on the exercise bike. Even if he was facing the other way, the angles are all wrong."
"Another unsolved mystery."
"You know," she said, "sometimes the perp takes the weapon home, like a souvenir. Or if it belonged to them, like the butt of a gun."
"That would have done it," Dombrowski agreed. "A dull, heavy object."
The coroner's words arose in Alice's mind as she scanned the landscape of the room. Blunt force trauma, back of the head. The techs were correct. Ruby's aversion to clutter and love of clean lines left the room quite barren. What had been used to hit George? Alice moved on to the room next door, which was set up as an office, a very messy one, with scattered papers, sticky notes, takeout containers, and dirty coffee mugs covering most of the surfaces. The room reflected George's eclectic sense of organization. Alice had worked with him in his capacity as a city administrator, and she'd had a taste of his administrative dysfunction. "Good thing I'm a numbers guy," he would say when someone complained about a missed meeting or an unanswered email. Back in the kitchen, Ruby was still talking with Taylor, with no sign of the detective yet. Alice noticed the sun beaming in the dining room window and stepped in for a bit of a lift. She was immediately reminded of the upcoming wedding of Ruby's daughter Celeste to Jamal Carter. Ruby had mentioned setting up a display of the wedding gifts for guests to peruse during the rehearsal dinner held here, a dinner that Alice, with her cooking expertise, had agreed to cater. Alice looked toward the kitchen, muttering, "That'll be creepy." In the dining room, the table and buffet and two card tables were festooned with linen tablecloths and covered with wedding gifts. Oversized or petite, shiny or burnished, outlandish or practical. The array of fine crystal, silver, china, and appliances had all the charm of a high-end shop. Alice strolled from one exhibit to the next, as if touring a fine arts museum. She passed bone china with a star in the center, a cappuccino maker, a Waterford crystal vase, a set of black cutlery. There were photos of trips to wine country and activities in Hawaii where the happy couple planned to honeymoon. "You know, Ruby," she called toward the kitchen, "you really outdid yourself with this display. Nordstrom needs you desperately."
funny because George said it made him feel like he was living in a department store, Ruby called back.
It's tastefully done.
At the base of each gift was a card indicating who provided it. Limoges Place Settings from Rihanna Nettles, Mr. and Mrs. Lionel Benjamin, and Corey Jefferson. Crystal Vase from Tansley Grand. The cut grooves in the crystal caught the light from the windows, a lovely gift from their town mayor. Marble cake stand from Darnetta Green. Celeste did enjoy baking. Brass candlestick holders from Dee Dee Doria.
I hope they have a sizable fireplace, Alice thought. Where else would you put such a large piece?
The candlestick holder was enormous, maybe 2 feet tall, but the warm brass was decorated with green rings, marble, perhaps. Grotesquely large, but Alice sort of liked it. Had Celeste and Jamal actually chosen this for their bridal registry?
Alice picked it up with a grunt. It was heavy, all right,
and sort of odd that there was only one.
She replaced it on the table and looked back at the card.
Candlestick holders, she said aloud as Madison appeared in the doorway.
Gran, Detective Petrosian is here and—
That's it?
Alice picked up the bronze piece and handed it to her granddaughter.
It's got heft, it's a blunt object, and its mate is missing.
Madison eyed the object in confusion.
What are you talking about?
I think the killer used the missing candlestick holder to hit George.
You're holding a copy of the murder weapon.
Chapter 4.
This thing must weigh 10 pounds. Madison's eyes opened wide as she tested the bronze piece in her hands, giving it a slight swing.
And the mate is missing?
I don't see it in this room, Alice said.
Let's ask Ruby. Madison was already ducking into the kitchen.
Alice gave a nod as she folded her arms in satisfaction. Madison would perform due diligence, but as far as Alice was concerned, this was it. She just had a feeling, not unlike that tingle when you land on your feet a bit too hard. The missing mate had been the weapon.
It didn't take Madison long to confirm that the candlestick holders had arrived as a matching set. The techs thought the size and weight might be a match based on preliminary measurements.
It's the right size, said Dombrowski, who had come down to the kitchen with his cohort, Gina.
I just wish we could find the other one, which is bound to have traces of blood or hair if it was used in the battery.
Good chance the attacker took it with him, said Gina. We've gone through the trash, the house, the yard, the bushes and whatnot. Nothing. No cast-off heavy objects.
Did you check the garage, too?
Pedrosian asked. The shirt-and-tie detective with salt-and-pepper hair and dark eyes had arrived abruptly and jumped into the situation without introduction. A bit rude by Alice's standards.
Maybe a tool.
The garage was clean, Dombrowski said. I couldn't even find a screwdriver.
My George was not a handyman, said Ruby, filling a glass with water from the fridge dispenser.
What are you doing?
The detective demanded of Ruby. She held up the glass, emphasizing the obvious.
This is my home.
But it's a crime scene.
Lines creased his forehead as he barked at Madison.
Didn't you explain it to her?
She's mindful of the investigation, Madison said. But she does live here. Detective Bedrosian let out a groan as he raked back his hair.
This is not a good day.
No kidding, Alice said.
When she stepped up to the detective, she towered over him. Not something she usually enjoyed, but in moments like this, it worked for her.
So maybe we should start over. This is Ruby Milliner, owner of this home and wife to the recently deceased. So far, this has been a very bad day for Ruby, but despite her loss, she has waited here patiently to speak with you because she wants to help your investigation.
Bedrosian squared his jaw, looking from Ruby to Alice.
And who are you?
Alice Pepper. She extended her hand, shaming him into a handshake. Ruby's good friend and neighbor.
And she's the director of the West Hazel Library, Taylor offered.
And she figured out the missing candlestick thingy, which could be important to your case, right?
As if on cue, Dombrowski held up the candlestick holder, and all eyes turned toward the detective, who seemed hard-pressed to emit a response from his tight lips.
It could be a clue, Madison said. We're sending it to the morgue for further analysis.
There's your answer, Bedrosian said. Looks like Officer Denham has the situation in hand.
Alice didn't miss the sarcasm in his tone. She'd had no idea that Madison worked under such a sourpuss detective. Still, relief suffused the air. Taylor gave her sister a grin, a rare moment of cooperation between sisters. The two technicians packed up the last of their evidence and started to load the vehicle. Ruby got to sip her water. Small victories.
All right, ladies, let's talk now.
Petrosian leaned against the kitchen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.